Industry Association. Please put your hands together for Mr. Kiwon.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be here on a couple of fronts, actually. So I often get asked, am I Malaysian? No, I'm Australian. I was born here. Born in KL, actually, and grew up in Penang. So Malaysia is my home as well, my second home. And I'm one of those products that the minister mentioned about education. So, you know, I went to Australia over 30 years ago to get an education and never left. But that's it. I have now come back to Malaysia. I've got a well-established business in Malaysia as well, and also in other parts of Asia. So today I'm talking to you in my capacity as the chairman of the ICT industry in Australia called AIIA. Now we have a strong relationship in the region and globally. AIIA, we're part of WITSA and certainly part of ASSOCIO. So we have a long established relationship with an equivalent association here called PCOM. And so SIFO, I see you in the audience somewhere. And certainly we have a long association in terms of our partnership with the Malaysian government and instruments, particularly with MDEC. So, Niran, thank you for appearing this morning. Okay. And Rob has already spoken quite a bit about the heritage between Australia and Malaysia, and certainly in particular where I come from, where I call home in Melbourne and Victoria. Australia has been a partner for Malaysia going a long, long time. I remember growing up in Penang with the Royal Australian Air Force Base in Butterworth, and certainly a lot of Australians travel between Butterworth and Penang. Australia came to Malaysia's aid when we had a bit of a confrontation issue with Indonesia going back in the back in the 60s, and certainly during the days of the emergency time in between the 40s and the 60s, with the rise of communism in this part of the world. So Australia has always been a friend of Malaysia in times of need. And I think now the world's changed. The world's changed in a way where the economy around the ASEAN region has grown to quite a significant stature. And Australia is also well recognized now to be part of Asia. We live in the same time zone. We are physically, geographically close. And the mix of the population now is very well established in terms of where the Asian communities are now accepting Australia as home. I'll highlight a few observations of mine. Having grew up here in Malaysia, having created my living and career out of Australia, but certainly working very, very much in the whole Asian region for many years. So what I would like to do is actually just show some couple of stats. I'm glad the minister talked about a few things without showing any numbers on, so we're not going to conflict when it comes to showing numbers. It's always a dangerous thing when you put numbers on, depends where your source is and how current it is. But it's good for people who don't know Victoria to be able to see the relative size of our economy. I haven't kept with the current Malaysian economy, but I think Victoria's size of economy is either about the same as Malaysia's economy, or maybe slightly bigger. And we do it with, in the next slide that I will show, is with a much less population. So the Victorian population is about 6 million people, and over two-thirds of that is in one city called Melbourne. So coming back to this, I think it's worthwhile noticing a couple of observations. That Victoria is the second largest economy in Australia, but it is also the second smallest state by geography in terms of size. And it's worthwhile pointing also that Victoria does not have natural resources in terms of mining. So all of Victoria created is high value economy based on services. And that's a reasonable size component in terms of agriculture. But more and more it's shifted towards high value food services as well. this particular chart, other than the interesting note about our population size, it is also looking at it from the growth. Victoria, by far, is the highest growth population state in Australia. And it sort of counters the 80s and 90s trend where a lot of people would move out of Victoria when they retire to go to the warmer climates up in Queensland. But I think people are now starting to realize that Victoria is actually a great place to develop business, to work, and also to live. So the next chart here shows the relative comparison between, just at the macro level, between Australia and Malaysia. As you can see, there are a couple of observations worth noting that has already been mentioned before, earlier on, that Malaysia has almost roughly about the same size of population as Australia. And the commonalities between Australia and Malaysia is both countries have got a mature economy, both countries have got a small population, both countries are surrounded by Asian neighbors that has got a much larger scale in terms of market size and population and workforce, and also a much more competitive cost base. So when you look at it, how is Malaysia going to compete against Thailand, Vietnam, Burma, which is coming up, is flavored a month with every Western country wanting to look at Asia, with Indonesia, that's about 250 million people, with Philippines, not to mention China and India. How is Malaysia, with 30 million people, going to compete in this region? Australia. Australia has 23 million people, which was ticked over 23, 11, 12 million population to keep employed. At the moment, we have the blessing of natural resources. So Australia and Malaysia is actually well placed to help each other out, because I think Australia and Malaysia need each other in this part of the world. So the long established relationship between Australia and Malaysia in terms of the links to education, I would say that if we do a straw poll, more than 50% of the people in this room would have either been educated in Australia or know someone who has, or maybe their own offspring has been educated in Australia. So the relationship is well established, the trust is already there. The heritage of the British, influence on both countries in setting up the government system, the judiciary system, the banking and finance governance, means that you can cut through a lot of red tape in terms of setting up partnerships because of the similarities between the two countries. Victoria, for some reason, have a lion's share of Malaysia's people when they go to education. Might be because of the clean air, the great water, the simple lifestyle. I can say that having grown up in terms of doing business in Australia, there's a significant, distinct difference between the two major, shall we say, centres, call it Sydney and Melbourne. Melbourne is very much relationship-based. Sydney is very much transaction-based. And so, and I'll give you one simple example. In Melbourne, as an industry organisation, we can always organise a lunch event, and you can fill the room, because people understand the importance of taking time out to come to lunch and build a relationship. In Sydney, it is almost impossible to organise a lunch event, because people are just too busy. So in Sydney, what you have to do is you organize a breakfast event that starts at 7:30, finished by 9, because everybody wants to get out of there. So when you start talking about building links into Australia and forming partnerships in business, there's no better place to build relationships than coming to Melbourne. This now shows, and I'll forward it so that I'm showing both Australia and Malaysia. The World Economic Forum publishes its index annually about the readiness for a country to leverage ICT for boosting its economic competitiveness as well as the well-being for its population. So there's a few dimensions, as you can see. Environmental type index about the political and regulatory environment in the country, the business and innovation environment, how well established the infrastructure is, and how affordable are those infrastructure, and we got the skills, to manage, develop, and maintain the infrastructure. And then there's the uptake at the individual, which is the consumer level, within business, within government, and then what the economic and social impacts are. Australia ranks at the moment 18 out of about 144 countries that's been surveyed. It'd be interesting for me to tell you which country is number one. Now, it's got nothing to do with size. It's got everything to do with how well you service the country and get business, individuals, and government to adopt it. Number one is Finland. Number two is Singapore. Those two are very small countries. Sweden is number three, Netherlands number four, number five is Norway. None of these countries have got population size bigger than Malaysia, Australia. Maybe Netherlands, I haven't checked up the population size there, but I don't think Netherlands is a huge country. UK is ranked number seven, US is number nine, Taiwan is number 10. It would be interesting to note for Malaysians that Malta is number 28. And Malaysia ranks number 30. So out of the index of seven, as they measure it, you can see here what I'm trying to highlight is there are opportunities for Australia to stretch itself further. We are not that worse off in terms of our ranking. Our network readiness index is number 18. I think we should be doing better than that. Malaysia, on the other hand, has a lot of room for improvement. What Australia and Malaysia brings together, other than the need for each other because of the size of our economy, is that one of the things that I do believe in what Michael Porter has said is that you cannot be a globally competitive organization unless you have a locally competitive a business. And size does matter in this case. If your market is not big enough, you will never be able to establish a global presence by developing it within your own economy. So given the similarities I've highlighted between Australia and Malaysia, we should partner initially for mutual marketplace, which is form a partnership where what Australia can bring to the Malaysian marketplace and what Malaysia can bring to the Australian marketplace. But the strategy long term should be about what each of us can partner to take to a third market. Now, Malaysia is well placed in this region, highly regarded in terms of its capabilities. If you go to countries like Vietnam or Thailand or China, there's a high likelihood that a senior exec of one of those large local companies, probably a Malaysian. If you look at Australia's CEOs around the world, particularly in the first world countries, you will find that a lot of Australians are well accepted as senior management, even CEOs of those global companies. And the reason is this, simply. In Australia, we have a small population. The hierarchical layers between the people on the shop floor and the CEO is not that high. You know, that not too many layers. Most of the Australian CEOs have come from the grassroots. They've started from the if you're an engineering firm, you've been an engineer, you work yourself through, and now you run a global engineering company. So Australia, similar to Malaysia, have a lot of hands-on type management team that have grown out of necessity. The two partnering companies will be quite synergistic in that sense. So what I'd like to do is to talk a little bit more now about my purpose for being here. Represents about 400 members, and of those 400 members, we represent about 80% of the ICT output. Last count is about 100 billion Australian dollars in output, and the composition of the board of AIIA includes companies like Singtel, Optus, IBM, Microsoft, Google, Intel, etc. And there are about three or four local companies, two of which are one of the largest listed companies in Australian Stock Exchange, SMS, and Data3. I chair the board. The deputy chairman is the managing director of IBM. We focus on making sure that we work with governments at the state level and federal level, that they provide a healthy environment for both investment and industry development. Companies should be partnering with global companies for market access, because every dollar you spend, you won't be able to reach the access that a global company can provide. So we spend a lot of our time looking at how we can create global ties. We spend a lot of our time talking about how global companies operating in Australia can be a leader to help develop the next generation of businesses, particularly in the ICT industry in Australia. I am delighted to say the minister is not in this room now, so I'll say it without the impression that I'm trying to impress him or to please him. That Victoria is probably the most advanced state in recognizing the importance of ICT for the economy. I have, in my role on AWI now for more than 10 years, I've been on the board now for about 7, and I must say that it's a delight to work with the Victorian government. Regardless of which party is governing the state, there's a continuity of investment in ICT, and the bureaucrats, people like Kathy and I have known each other, and she's worked for different governments before, and Gladney Mills here has been a CIO of the state of South Australia, and prior to that had done work with the Victorian government under different government system. But I can say that every minister that have come in into the role of technology understands the importance of technology in a modern economy. So I'm delighted to say that I call Victoria home. Investments now, I'm seeing some of the things that I do apart from running IT business is about investment. We are looking at a lot, the consortiums that I work with in Sydney and in Melbourne and in Singapore are looking at a lot of proposals that is about a global and regional marketplace. We have not seen a single proposal that says, I want to develop a business in Australia. Most of the opportunities now is Australia could be a launching pad, but the market is in this time zone, in this region. Singapore is a very attractive place because it's sheer location, being central, but it is also a very cash-rich country looking for investments. And guess what? It's a small country, so there's not too many business opportunities in Singapore to invest in. They're now looking at investing overseas. And this, that's just the nature by which what Singapore government has successfully created wealth for its nation. I flew in yesterday, I'm flying out 6 p.m. today. I do support everything that the government does in terms of promoting trade internationally. And it's very easy for me to do an overnight trip back to Malaysia. As I said, you know, I call Malaysia home as well. Now, I've covered most of the points that I highlighted here, and relationship already well established. Malaysia is well linked into the ASEAN region, and people should not be looking at partnering with Malaysian companies only for Malaysian market, but it's in the ASEAN region. Australia, on the other hand, is very well regarded in the first world countries. So for Malaysian companies that wanted the first world credibility, you cannot find a better partner than a partner with an Australian company to access US, Europe, and Canadian market. However, all this is hard work. I can tell you it's really hard work. It's not going to be easy. There'll be lots of business card, lots of luncheons, lots of seminar and business matching meetings. At the end of the day, I think like the funnel, you have a lot outside the funnel, you put it through the funnel and filter, at the end of the day you might drop one or two relationships. But how do you know that you will get to the one or two if you don't start with 30 or 50 meetings to start with? So I advise you to say, don't give up. It's never going to be easy. You have to do the hard grind and the rewards will eventually come. So I'll leave you with a message that says trade missions like this is only a step in a long journey. I always advise people that you build relationships when you don't need them. Coming to a trade mission like this, I mean, the minister starts off to say we're here to do business, yes. But at the same time, let's build relationships for mutual benefit rather than this is what I want from you or what I can get from you and vice versa. So you build relationship for the sake of relationship. Something may come through at the end of the line later on, maybe directly or indirectly. And I think being an Asian myself, growing up in Asia, I've already made a comment about the difference between Melbourne and Sydney in terms of relationship building. You build relationships for the long term. And today, for some of you, might be a beginning of a long journey. So, and you know, it's a bit like painting by numbers or painting by dots. The more dots you put on the paper, the clearer the picture becomes. And you can never see what the picture is going to look like looking forward by jumping those dots. But I can assure you, my own experience says that when you look backwards, you will definitely see the rewards of putting more dots on the paper. So I wish you all well in your trade mission. I'd like to say that I wish I could stay, but I have other duties back in Canberra, which dictates that I need to fly out tonight so that I can meet my commitments tomorrow, Wednesday. So happy to for people to chat to me after this. I will be with the minister for a few meetings rest of the afternoon. And you've got my contact details there. More than happy to take emails and phone calls from you. Okay, thank you.
I'd like to relationships. I've been here in Malaysia for 12 and a half, coming up 13 years. And at the beginning, when I first moved to Malaysia, I was with BHP Billiton, which is now BlueScope Steel. And as the chief marketing officer of BlueScope Steel here in Malaysia, I thought the brand would sell itself and that people would be rushing towards me to do business. It's not like that. Here in Malaysia, it's probably 80% to 90% is based on relationships. So please feel free to create some really firm relationships with the people who you're going to be meeting today in the roundtables and in the business matching sessions. And this is, as Kee Wong was saying, this is the beginning of a long journey for the Victorian and the Malaysian companies in building very solid foundations through relationships. In moving on,